he thought that the key document that this case really should depend on was a letter that the previous Rebbe had written after he got to the United States and was trying to get the books to be brought back from Europe, found and brought back from Europe to the United States, a letter that he had written to Professor Marx, who was the librarian of the Jewish Theological Seminary Library in New York. And this letter said that this library was a treasure of the Jewish people and belonged to Agudas Hasidei Chabad of the United States. But the Rebbe said to us, look, the key document is this one which he wrote to Professor Marx.
The defendant argued that the letter, written by the previous Rebbe in the aftermath of World War II as he tried to recover the collection from Poland, was not intended as a literal fact. To the Rebbe, the assertion that his Rebbe would write something other than his true intent was the gravest affront. The Rebbe wrote, "This argument is foolishness. In all the official documents, the previous Rebbe named Agudas Chabad as the owner, whereas their arguments to the contrary are merely hypothetical." Rebbetzin Chayamushka, daughter of the previous Rebbe and wife of the Rebbe, was deposed in her home under the watch of a physician. After 3 hours of questioning, she was asked, "Did the library belong to your father or to the Hasidim?" The Rebbetzin replied simply, "They belong to the Hasidim, because my father belonged to the Hasidim." 5 months after the Rebbe first mentioned the theft publicly, on December 3, 1985, the 20th of Kislev, 5746, the trial finally began. It became obvious that the case was taking a heavy toll on the Rebbe and the Rebbetzin. While his usual practice was to visit the resting place of the previous Rebbe twice a month, for the 3 weeks the trial was in session, the Rebbe spent almost every single day at the Ohel, fasting until his return to Crown Heights in the evening. In the 35 years of his leadership, Hasidim could not recall seeing such an obvious display of concern. Every morning, many Hasidim rose early to recite the entire Book of Psalms. Some took upon themselves to fast until midday. Busloads of elderly Hasidim, yeshiva students, men and women would head for the courthouse, where they'd earnestly watch the lineup of authors, researchers, and rabbis on the witness stand as they responded to the examination and cross-examination of the attorneys. At almost every public address he delivered during the trial, the Rebbe referred to the proceedings.
To leave the matzav miyuchad in welt, was midaf hoven vibald artishka hachama, bekame vekame inyonim. Darf man haben eine Simche, wo sie soll peilig sein, echt unter dem Geische, und nehmen wir Wattel sein, die Gammere soll nicht bleiben, kein Reichen klar und klar, und soll Adrabe soll sein der Reichen von kein Jirbe, der kein Jifreis, wo das wird peilig sein, der peilig ist jeder, und Puftol, als kein Jirbe, der kein Jifreis, Bizu Faratsto, Yomova, Kedma, Vitsofenova, Negbo, und der Fahrrad nechet mäßig sein, Lejachere Kola Nigunim, Eche dem Nigen, von Faratsto.
As an expression of the intense joy he was calling for, The Rebbe urged that gatherings be held on each remaining day of Hanukkah, calling two previously unplanned farbrengens during the trial. The Rebbe compared the situation to the imprisonment of Rabbi Schneer Zalman, the Alter Rebbe, by the Tsar in 1798. The Alter Rebbe later explained that his arrest, which had put the entire Hasidic movement in jeopardy, had been triggered by a decree in the heavenly court. Responding to allegations lodged in the courtroom the previous week, the Rebbe taught that the answer must be similar to Rabbi Schneer Zalman's response in
1798. And